Welcome to Season 5 of Public Health On Call, a podcast from the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. I'm Joshua Sharfstein, Vice Dean for Public Health Practice and Community Engagement and a former health commissioner here in Baltimore, Maryland. Our goal with this podcast is to bring scientific evidence and experience to shed light on critical health issues. If you have questions or ideas for us, please send an email to publichealthquestion@jhu.edu. That's publichealthquestion@jhu.edu for future podcast episodes.
Hi, I'm Lindsay Smith-Rogers, producer of Public Health On Call, and today Stephanie Desmon welcomes back Keri Althoff and Elizabeth Stuart of the Johns Hopkins Bloomberg School of Public Health. They discuss how to navigate life where masks are becoming optional and COVID-19 cases are down, but one that isn't quite risk-free, especially for the young and the sick. Let's listen.
Keri Althoff and Liz Stuart, thanks so much for joining me again.
Thanks for having us.
So here we are, March 2022, and it feels like the world is reopening, right? Masks are optional in schools, at the mall, in the movie theater. Cases are way down from their recent peaks. Are we done with COVID?
We are definitely in a good spot right now, but we're unfortunately not done with COVID, or maybe COVID isn't done with us. I think many of us, as you just said, are starting to really see that the next period of time, I don't know how long that will be, but we're in a good spot in general right now in the United States. Cases are down. Many people are vaccinated, not as many as we might want. And so I know even myself and many others are starting to do more than we have for the past couple of years, going out, et cetera. I think that the thing to remember, and sort of where COVID isn't necessarily done with us, is that this might change. And so we should enjoy the time we have now, but we also should be prepared to be monitoring metrics and to recognize that maybe at some point mask mandates will come back or that, but we can be prepared for that. And we've gotten through it in the past and we can do so again. And there's still some populations that I think we'll come back to in this conversation. So certainly groups and situations we still want to be mindful of even now. But I think we're in a good spot now, and hopefully it will continue for quite a while.
Keri, do you have any concern, though, if we continue on this path and we get a variant, that it'll be really hard to go back to things like masking?
I think we just have to recall that we were in a similar kind of bright spot last year at this time. And then we did go back to masking because we saw those numbers tick up. We saw people around us getting sick. And I think we have to give ourselves the credit where the credit is due. We have become very flexible. We understand what is happening around us, and we are responding. And being a part of the response has been helpful to keeping so many of us and our families and our communities safe. So is this going to be something that we have to, you know, at some point begin to layer on those mitigation strategies again, like indoor masking? Yeah, I think that's highly likely, to be totally honest. It's only been 2 years, which seems like an eternity. But in the grand scheme of what we know about infectious diseases that emerge, 2 years is not that long. We're not fully endemic yet. So we have to be prepared. And I think our flexibility shown over this last year, as we thought, okay, vaccines are here, this is going to give us a fresh start. And then we had Delta, and then Delta showed, and we thought, okay, we're all going to have Christmases and December holidays that we didn't in the past. And then Omicron came. So I think we're anxious to reclaim some of the things we used to do. And we can do that now because we're in a safe spot. But are we going to perhaps have to add on some additional mitigation strategies in the future? Given the fact that our global population, the vast majority of whom are not vaccinated, could still be, you know, harboring virus. Virus replication equals mutation. Mutation can add up to variants. So we just have to be prepared. We can't become complacent, but we can definitely enjoy the downtick in COVID numbers right now.
So as we make decisions, Keri, can you talk a little bit about what the CDC has been telling us?
So the CDC just changed their approach to monitoring COVID risk in our communities. So it was heavily reliant on COVID-19 transmission rate and the percent of tests that were positive. And now it's kind of moved to look at, again, the COVID-19 transmission rate, but really focusing in on the number of hospital admissions with COVID and the number of individuals who are in hospital beds who have COVID. Now, what that does because it gives us a measurement of whether or not the healthcare system is under strain. It also gives us a measurement about how much severe illness is in our communities. So when health systems are under strain and we have a lot of severe illness, it puts everybody at a little bit of an increased risk for negative health outcomes if something were to happen, right? You don't want to be in a car accident when the hospital is overwhelmed with COVID, right? So I think these measures start to pivot us a little bit. It's not just about preventing infections. It's about preventing severe disease. And that is in alignment with what we know about our effective prevention strategies, and that's vaccination. So it's, you know, upon everybody to make that choice for themselves and their families about vaccination. That is the way to prevent more severe illness. And then as we progress, these indicators of risk in our community will kind of continue to look at severity of disease in our communities, not necessarily only the number of cases.
Liz, talk to me about those people who can't get vaccinated. I mean, there are plenty of people who've chosen not to, and that's a whole other issue, but there are people who cannot get vaccinated. How should we be moving through life with those folks right now?
Yeah, it's really important to keep those people as part of the conversation and sort of keep them in mind, both in terms of them thinking about behaviors that they can take, but then really, almost more importantly, the measures that the rest of us can take to help keep them safe. And so in particular right now, the groups of concern might be kids under 5 who are not yet eligible for vaccination, and then people with compromised immune systems or other health conditions that mean that the vaccines are potentially less effective for them. And so that's where we really do have a responsibility. You know, the rest of us getting vaccinated can help keep cases down and kind of keep transmission low. In addition, we can wear masks if we know that we might be in an event or, you know, a church service or some other store where there might be people around, where we want to make sure to help keep them safe. So it really is about the individual behaviors, family behaviors, and community behaviors to help keep everyone safe. And it really is important to help to make sure that they are still part of these considerations. And I think people can sometimes get frustrated by the fact that sometimes mitigation approaches are still in place and they think, well, why do we need this? And sometimes it's to protect those vulnerable groups. We see healthcare facilities, for example, still generally requiring masks, in fact, required nationally. Same for other large events. We might still see mask mandates at those sorts of things because of this idea of trying to keep people safe, especially, you know, everyone safe, including those who can't be vaccinated.
There's a concern, Keri, about how well the vaccine is working in kids aged 5 to 11, but it's still important for parents to get those kids vaccinated, right?
Yeah, so there was some concerning data that came out just very recently looking at those kids 5 to 11 and how well the vaccine protected them. And you know, the bottom line is we have to remember that the vaccine is here to prevent severe illness, right? So we get vaccinated so that we don't end up hospitalized with COVID or worse. But are people going to have what we call breakthrough infections where they might get COVID after getting vaccinated? Yeah, that can definitely happen. We saw more of that with Omicron than we did with Delta, just the sheer number of cases with Omicron. So for these kids in particular, even though the data suggests, you know, a good proportion of them were infected, it's important to know that the vaccine was very effective against keeping them out of the hospital still, keeping them away from that very severe disease. So that's important. And, you know, I'm a parent. I have 3 kids. The other thing we have to remember about our children is that, you know, many of them go to school. They're in that environment where, you know, you consider it high exposure, right? They're mixing with a lot of people. Schools have recently reduced their mask mandates. And I not only think about my children in that school, I think about the other children in that school. And then I think about their families. My children are elementary school age. The number of families that have kids under 5 in that are circulating, you know, within our community, our school community, is pretty high. The number of pregnant women. And that's just, you know, from what you can kind of detect in your community, that doesn't take into consideration the cancer survivors or people who are undergoing therapies that result in immune suppression or people who have chronic immune suppression, you know, some of which you can't always, you know, detect. So I think, you know, thinking very carefully about vaccinating 5 to 11-year-olds is critical for all parents. And just remembering that, you know, the goal is help to protect them from hospitalization if they were to be infected with COVID, and also so that they can contribute to the population level immunity. So hopefully we can slow COVID down if it comes into our school communities, particularly when they're connected to children who are not eligible for vaccination or families who have individuals immune suppressed.
I'm curious actually about whether your children are choosing to wear masks in school or not. My children are 18 and 15, and I feel as though it's not up to me. But I'm curious about both of you, Keri.
So we've had a lot of conversations about masks, and I have three kids, and they all feel very differently about masks, and they all have different risk tolerances, which is fascinating to me. So we have a lot of good conversations about it, and I wanted to present them with that choice because I want them to understand that where we're at right now, it is a choice. And I think the thing that hurts us all is when we outwardly judge others for their choices, right? We have to be a little bit more empathetic than that. I have asked them to consider wearing a mask when they are in large gatherings. And when I took them to church on Wednesday for Ash Wednesday, we all wore our masks. There was just way too many people for me to feel comfortable. But interestingly, they were all very in tune with that. And so I think when we think forward about how our kids are handling this, you know, empowering them to be a part of these decisions, just as you said, Stephanie, when you have older children, can you really, you know, we have to be coaches, I think, here. And when there are times where we know there's an elevated risk, we have to be strong in our coaching. But I, you know, when they're in their school classroom and my children are fully vaccinated and our school is still doing a lot of additional testing and contact tracing, I'm more comfortable with them taking their masks off.
Liz, your kids?
We're in a somewhat different situation because our schools actually still have an indoor mask mandate. I have a fifth grader and an eighth grader. But sort of as Keri was describing, we're starting to have conversations about, you know, what things might look like if or when the indoor mask mandate goes away in their schools. And like Keri described, I think they have slightly different perspectives, maybe the difference between elementary school boy and an eighth grade girl. But it's been really good to be able to have sort of these conversations in advance, you know, sort of not in the moment, hey, kids, put your mask on immediate, but conversations about sort of what are our values and what are the, how do we think about the different trade-offs and when are we comfortable wearing a mask or when are we less comfortable, or, you know, sort of making those decisions and thinking about it in advance. You know, I think one sort of side anecdote, both of my kids have been very comfortable with mask wearing in general. Neither of them has really put up sort of concerns, and it sort of is just part of their day to day and not a big deal for them. My eighth grader, in fact, said, well, Mom, if we don't have the mask mandates, then people might see my whole face and like, maybe they're not going to, you know, like what I look like as much as just my eyes. So there's all sorts of considerations for these kids who have been in this environment for 2 years, part of that with virtual school and part of it now back in school in person. And so I think just having open conversations with them and helping, as Keri said, sort of providing that sort of coaching and help just sort of thinking through the different considerations is really important. And I really want to reiterate her point too about setting a standard of not judging people one way or the other. We're going to have all sorts of circumstances where there will be some people in a room masked and others unmasked. And we need, as society, to sort of accept that and sort of recognize that different people are going to have different considerations.
I guess I was going to add that I have this question I wrote, and it doesn't, and it says, how safe is it to return to normal, whatever that means? So I'm curious, Liz and Keri, as we wrap this up, what are your thoughts?
I'm feeling pretty good, in the at least, you know, looking ahead from where the data is now and approaching spring and outdoor activities. I think the thing that I think about a lot is that this also isn't a full on off switch. You know, we don't have to sort of say mitigation strategies are in place or they're not. You know, for families of kids in school, a lot of schools have enhanced ventilation and that will continue, you know, long term, which is wonderful. Mask wearing, we can make choices. And again, we can sort of think in advance, what are the scenarios where we're going to want to put a mask on? Even if we're in a case where maybe cases are lower, you know, as Keri said, going to a church service with a lot of people, a lot of elderly individuals, perhaps a lot of kids under five, not yet vaccinated. So I think it's important not to just think about this as a sort of on-off switch, but to be thinking about dialing up and down these levers of mitigation strategies so that we can sort of make smart choices, but also enjoy the times when we can to be with friends and getting back to social gatherings and indoor activities.
I'm feeling very hopeful right now. I'm concerned that our vaccination rate has plateaued and we can't seem to dislodge that. I think having vaccines available for 6 months to 5-year-olds will be really important for families. But, you know, the CDC did show 43% seroprevalence people with antibodies between December and January in a recent study. So that Omicron wave, you know, it walloped us, but we are riding a bit of a bubble of population immunity from it right now. We do know that will wane. But like I said, you know, we need to enjoy when the numbers are looking good. And we need to do the things that make us happy. We need to do the things that connect us with others. I'm hoping to take my kids to see extended family over their spring break. But I am also going to be watching the genomic surveillance. I'm going to be keeping an eye out for additional variants. And the new thing that I'm most fascinated with is the wastewater surveillance, and not just what the results are, but also how many communities are starting to do this. It's an amazing process to watch and a very strong indicator of increasing cases. So I really am hopeful right now and very impressed with our public health approach to this and how many different tools we have on hand now, 2 years into this pandemic. So I'm going to definitely enjoy the time we have and just keep an eye out for the moment where I think we need to show our flexibility and perhaps mitigate, add on a few mitigation strategies.
Well, Keri Althoff and Elizabeth Stuart, thank you so much for joining me.
Thanks, Stephanie.
Thanks so much.
Public Health On Call is produced by Joshua Sharfstein, Lindsay Smith-Rogers, and Stephanie Desmon. Audio production by Niall Owen McCusker, Matthew Martin, Spencer Greer, and Holly Cardinale, with support from Chip Hickey. Distribution by Nick Moran. Production support from Catherine Ricardo. Social media support from Grace Holz Fernandez. Thank you for listening.